Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. I hope that you got a lot of coffee because we are going to speak about the security, and it's so exciting, you know. My name is Victoria. I do work in the Microsoft Norway, and my role requires to help the customers to protect the development architecture, cloud-native architecture stuff, and so on. And my background is like more than 15 years in the security, so I'm mostly working with the developers and architects to help them to make environments, applications, solutions secure from the beginning. And as you can see, there is my GitHub and Twitter account, so if you're going to have the questions later, you can just write me and I'm always coming back. Okay. So, like I mentioned, I hope that you got the coffee, and I have a small riddle for you. Have you seen these numbers before? Any guess what these numbers mean? People, come on, no guess? Okay, so these are the real numbers of the proportions. Proportions of the 100 developers, 10 IT ops, and one security. This is like the common proportion what I have seen. And I used to be like one of the security towards the teams, like around 200 developers. And it becomes quite challenging to help them to secure stuff when you're alone and you have a lot of the developers. And this is like the common situation in the companies. So think about your organization. How many security persons you have in your organization? And what we are mostly doing, are we collaborating with you? Are we working with you? Are we capable like to cover your security issues and the security questions? So that was like my life all the time. I was working with the developers, I was implementing secure development lifecycle and such stuff, and once they started to come with me like with the new cool things like, oh, we're going to do agile. And you know, there is a DevOps thing, continuous integration, continuous delivery. I was like, okay, what does that mean? That means we're going to make the releases like once per week. And I was like, okay, how it's going to work with the security? How it's going to work with the pen tests? And I was like, it's a way to the catastrophe, you know? So I was really scared a bit, and I thought like if the developers with whom I'm dealing all the time, and they are like, you know, if there is a release once per month, and we are short in time to go to fix the security issues, how it's going to look in the DevOps world? And I was a bit critic on the DevOps at the beginning. But now I'm on the stage, and I'm fully supporting the DevOps. So before jumping into the DevOps concept, I would like to remind you what is actually the DevOps. We hear a lot around the DevOps. People think, some people I have seen, they think that this is like, oh, okay, we're going to hire the DevOps team and we do the DevOps. Or we're going to hire the DevOps engineer and it's going to be cool. Now our company is a DevOps. And it's like, no, no, that thing doesn't work like that. So how many of you have, like, you know, implemented DevOps in your organization? Can you raise a hand? Can you keep the hand? Because I have a next question. How many of you have successfully implemented DevOps? That's okay. Yeah, that's a good number. Because we tend to think that the DevOps is all about the tooling, like, hey, bring the Kubernetes, let's go to the Amazon, to Azure, whatsoever, Google Cloud, and we're going to be, like, you know, working in the DevOps. Some people think that it's all about, like, you know, some processes that we are going to deliver faster stuff and so on. Yes and no. At least in the Microsoft, this is like the way how we ended up. We defined for us that the DevOps is the union of the people, process, and technology to enable continuous delivery of value to your end users or to your customers. So that means that I specifically have emphasized the four words. Combination of the people, process, and technology. And believe me, working in the security field, I found out that the hardest thing is not about the tool. It's all about the people. So implementing DevOps, changing the mindset of the people, it was like, it's sometimes it's almost not possible, because we tend to be like, we love to be in our safety zone and we don't want to change. And with the DevOps, I'm working a lot with the teams, and I'm telling that security is not anymore my responsibility. Now you're working in the DevOps, the security is the same as ops, is your responsibility as a team. So, but I could speak like all the session about the people and like tell some stories from my success and the failure. That deserves just another topic. But with the DevOps, we also got the things like continuous integration, continuous delivery, and automation, right? Infrastructure as a code. And this is where I would like to focus as for today. So back then, when I was quite skeptic on the DevOps, I thought like, okay, but maybe this is not actually the bad thing, because DevOps brings us automation. And that's cool. Everything in the DevOps is all about the automation. Automate the processes, automate the checklists, automate delivery, and so on. So I was like, okay, why not to automate security then? So basically, why not to automate the stuff what I'm doing manually, checking the your solution, like, you know, the developed solution for the security, and then so on. And then I realized that the DevOps is a cool thing, actually. So, okay, how do we automate the security? There is a famous security guy, and he said, like, you know, and I really like this song, actually, and there's a good quote in that, that every step what you are doing in the development, you can automate in terms of the security. So basically, in every step, starting from the development to the release, we can integrate the security by shifting the security to the left. And this is what we call, is for today, DevSecOps. And CI/CD pipeline is the heart of the DevSecOps. But to be able to understand that, I'm going to go through the whole storyline, starting from the development till the release. So how do we deliver the product? How do we deliver our solution? We start with the development, we commit the code, then we create the build. Build puts us on the acceptance stage, like, you know, the development creates the stage, and if the business product owners are happy, we go to the production, and then it fails into the operations. So basically, we start to monitor, and then we repeat our cycle. So in all of these five steps, we can add the security. Some of the processes we can automate, some of them we still need to work with the human factor. Let's go through the, each of them. Let's start with the development stage. So the goal for this development stage is to fix security from the first line of the code. Basically, you start to work with the developers, explain them the security stuff, and when they are developing, when they are writing the lines of the code, they already should get the feedback if they are doing very well. And there are a few practices. First of them is the threat modeling. So I don't want to overcomplicate. I usually, when I explain the threat modeling, I start simple. Take your team. And when you have your sprint planning, you already know the features, what you're going to develop. Then take your team and take the brainstorming meeting. Like for the brainstorming, take the whiteboard and start to think about your features as a hacker. Literally, okay, we're going to implement this authentication. If I would be the bad person, how I would try to hack it, like, you know, the brute force stuff and then so on. And you write down these threats, and then you immediately write down the protection stuff. This is the simplest way how to start the threat modeling. And later, if you become more and more advanced, there are a lot of the tools. Usually, I prefer to say that start with the concept, start simple, and later go and buy the tool. Because tools doesn't solve the issue if you don't have the understanding. So if you've done the threat modeling, the next step is kind of free willing, which is something what security team cannot push because we can't impact your local development environment. But we always suggest use the security plugins. You are using different development environments like Eclipse, Visual Studio Code, name it. Unless you're using the Notepad or something like this, like Vim, they all EDAs in today's world, they have the security plugins. So these plugins are the open source commercial ones, which helps you to analyze your code while you're typing and saying like, hey, it seems that you are going to write the SQL injection. Maybe it's not a good idea, for example, to keep the secret in the in your code, and then so on. Then mostly we are dealing like in today's world, we developing, we use Git, right? So if you are in the GitHub, why not to use the pre-commit hooks? I used to work with the team where we wrote with pre-commit hooks just to check the quality of the code, just to check that the credentials are not pushed with the code to the repository, because you know what happens in repository stays always in repository. Always you need to clean the full history. So what you can do, you can write the pre-commit hooks, which checks the basic security baseline. Like I mentioned, that the credentials are not pushed in the repository. And when you're developing, you usually have the agreements about the best practices on the coding standards. So why not to add the some lines of the sentences about the security? Like, in our organization, there is a common practice to do like this. So add also the security coding standards. Peer review. Big companies do that. Amazon does that. Etsy does. Google, Microsoft. We do this. Because peer review always helps to see. Usually we write the code, our eyes get blurry. We stop to see some, like, you know, things, and it helps that some senior developer looks on our code and says like, hey, why you have done like this? So maybe you have the dev, senior dev person who is like more experienced with the security things, so he can focus also on your code and look on the peer review. But as you can see on the development stage, there are a lot of the things which are related to the human process. So it's not about the automation, but still these common concepts, these common practices, they help a lot. Okay, but we have done our development and now it's time to push our code to the repository. And we want to be sure that our code is secure and get the feedback as fast as possible. One of the things, and it was also already mentioned here on the previous talk, about the quality is the static code analysis tools. There are a lot of the static code analysis tools, which are like the open source or the commercial. And I usually suggest, and from my experience, I usually suggest to run with static code analysis tools towards the repositories, not towards the build pipeline. Because if the security analysis tool is going to stop your build, the next step, what you're going to do as a team, you will just disable it. And you will not use it. And I have seen that, because it's like we don't want to stop the process of continuous integration, continuous development, but we still want to be aware about our security issues. So the best way, if the tool is run against to the repository, and it gives you the feedback, it gives the feedback about the common security patterns, so the developers will get the feedback if something is bad, publish it in the code, and they need to fix that. We write the unit tests for the quality, and for the same reasons, think about the security unit tests. What to write, you got it already from the threat modeling exercise. You get the things what you think needs to be tested and from the threat modeling, and you put them also as a unit test. And the biggest, the third one, which I believe is the biggest one, is dependency management. So how development looks today in today's world? We are using a lot of the packages from the different sources, right? So it's like, especially if you think about the JavaScript, we're grabbing one library, another library. Do you have actually the dependency management system which checks that your dependencies, your libraries are up to date, or even if you are using them? And this is like the biggest security issue, because you're grabbing the third party code, you know nothing about that, and then if there is a security issue there, your code is affected. Or even like, let's not speak about the security, let's think from the licensing perspective. Today that library is for free, tomorrow that library is changing the license, and it's that license is going to push you to open source your full product where you are using that library. How the company is going to react on this. So the dependency management is crucial for the security, for the quality's sake. So if I would take only one step, I would start with the dependency management. Okay, so we are on the continuous delivery. So we are pushing the code to the development stage, to the QA stage. And this is where you can add, in your pipeline, you can add the things like, definitely, infrastructure as a code is by default. If you are doing the CI/CD, then you are using infrastructure as a code, which could be like Terraform. Let's take as a Terraform example. So what you can do, you can integrate in your CI/CD pipeline on the release stage, checks your infrastructure code against some security policies. And there are a lot of the tools which can help you. So basically what you do, you check that, okay, I'm provisioning the VM with the public IP, with the SSH open to the whole world, or RDP, without the firewall. So that's not a good thing. Then the build should fail. So these type of the things, and this is where I believe, like, for me, DevOps became the cool thing, because I'm not spending any more time on the pen testing environment to find out the configuration. I can check it in the simple, like, you know, text file, literally, like JSON format and so on. It depends what you're using. Yeah. So infrastructure as a code is a bless for the security, because you can automate infrastructure checks. Security scanning. So what you can do when it comes to the CI/CD pipeline, when you have released your software, or before, like when you have released that on the dev stage, you can scan it. There are plenty open source tools. I will just name it OWASP ZAP scanning tool. So what you can do is to add in your CI/CD pipeline task which spins up the OWASP ZAP scanner Docker, and that scanner tool is scanning that infrastructure and gives you the report about your web application security state. And it's done automatically, so there is no need for the security person to be involved. Cloud configuration. It depends which cloud provider you are using. All of them are giving you some security suggestions, some security tools, and I always suggest to follow them. And this is something what you get out of the box on the cloud itself. Amazon gives, I think it was Guard. In Azure, there is a security center. All of them helps you to see the status of the cloud configuration. And you can automate the things like getting the output and such stuff. Security acceptance testing. So basically, when you are doing other type of the testing, why not include also the same security stuff what you have discussed on the threat modeling, and you are testing that these things have been implemented. Okay, so we are like going on the production stage. which literally mirrors the things what you have done maybe for the development stage, but goes maybe more in deep. Some smoke tests, the same. If you have the smoke tests for the production, just add some, like, you know, security tests there. Configuration checks. Usually what I suggest when you work with the cloud and when it comes to the development stage, like if we speak about the Amazon, there is a development account. If we speak about Azure, it's like development subscription, where developers should have the full freedom. Work through the portal, through the scripts, connecting directly, and then so on. But when it comes to the production, definitely the first thing is there should not be a direct access towards the production account or the production subscription. Only CI/CD pipeline should have an access there. So everything, all the steps needs to be done through the CI/CD pipeline. Infrastructure should be deployed and created through the CI/CD pipeline. Why? Because if you have some issues, or if you have done some, oh, okay, I'm going to implement the new feature, and you're going to do this change directly in the production, who knows? Nobody. That's not like the DevOps style. And that's a short way to get the failure. So that's why you have these configuration checks. You're checking that your configuration comes directly through the CI/CD pipeline, that the templates or Terraform have been applied, and there is no manual steps have been done through the portal or through the console, and so on. And of course, we can talk a lot about the DevOps, we can talk a lot about the automation, but when you're delivering the huge project, the huge feature, sometimes it's worth to wait for the penetration testing. Because even if you have covered a lot of the steps, like on the previous where I was discussing around the OWASP scanner tool, that's just an overview. Penetration test gives you more deeper understanding. Sometimes it's worth to hire good security persons who are going to go through your environment and your solution, and they will check it. Of course, that doesn't fit with our continuous delivery. But if there are risks too big, sometimes it's worth to wait these 2 weeks. And of course, if we are on the production, there are the few things. It's like it's all about the continuous monitoring. And that's not for the security's sake. That's a DevOps principle. How you learn, how you improve by getting the feedback. How you get the feedback, you monitor your solution. Because the only way how to learn something new about your solution, that you have released the new feature and that feature is used, is tracing and monitoring and seeing that the users are using that feature. And the same log data you're going to use for the security. This is where you can catch and check that something suspicious is ongoing. If you don't have the monitoring data, how do you know that someone is not trying to compromise your solution right now? Threat intelligence, that's more advanced, and I should say that I have not seen so far, like in the last 3 years. Actually, I have seen, but really the few clients who, like the customers or the teams who went to the threat intelligence. So basically, the threat intelligence is something more advanced when your organization is signing up for the threat intelligence communities, which are gathering the data about common threats going on the world, and you can get and also feed that information to them if something as a threat comes to you, and then so on, so attacks and so on. But luckily, the cloud providers are doing this. So basically, some of the cloud providers, they do provide this stuff already for you, because when you are in the cloud, you are not alone. And the cloud provider is protecting not only your solution, they are protecting their own cloud. So the threat intelligence is something what is heavily used to different cloud providers, and it's based on even on the machine learning and so on. But I have placed this just to give you the full picture. vulnerability assessment. So even if your solution is in operational mode, I usually suggest that that doesn't hurt if you are having the SaaS solution, which constantly scans your infrastructure and your solution, like the developed solution, in the cloud, in the production, for the vulnerabilities. Because you have published your, for example, web application today, and tomorrow someone found the security bug in one of the libraries. So vulnerability assessment will gonna trigger that and will give you information that it's time to update. It's time to update your solution. It's time to update that library because it's like it contains security issue. And the biggest and most important, what I'm telling, like blameless postmortems. This comes from the DevOps principles. So it's all about the lessons to learn. It's not possible to create the security properly from the first or even third try. You're gonna fail, and that's okay. This is where we speak from the DevOps perspective, that the failure, how we say, fail fast, learn fast, right? And the same goes with the security. If you get the security issue, okay, if you got the compromise, that's not a good thing. Yeah, I should agree. But if you got the compromise, don't try to hide the stuff who was like guilty for that or try just to fix it and forget. No, sit down with the team and go for that lesson, what you have learned and how to avoid this stuff next time. And also, in this case, you learn how to react on the incident so you can improve your reaction on the incident next time. The most important here is a human factor, that you stop blame someone. So the team should be free from fear of the punishment and so on. That's important stuff. So, but it all comes from the DevOps. And a lot of the things what I showed here, actually they are like integrated into DevOps, because the one of the main principles of the DevOps are quality, right? To bring the safe and quality product. So if you put all together, this is like, if you get back to that every step you take, I will watching you, these are the all practices and all the concepts in one place. And it's worth to start at least like picking up one of the step and implementing on each of your stage of development. Okay, let's look how it looks on the practical example. We have a developer, on my side it's on the left, on your side it's on the right, who is developing the code and pushing the code to some of the EDA. And usually how we do, in the Git workflow we could have the future branches or just the development branch. In this simplified example we do have like the development branch. Okay, we have pushed our code to the development branch, which triggers our CI/CD pipeline. We build our product, and then if it's in this particular example, I do have example with the Docker, because everyone is fan of the AKS in today's world. So, Kubernetes, sorry, of Kubernetes. So, if I'm building the image, I'm pushing that to the Docker repository where I'm storing my Docker image, and then the release pipeline gets triggered. We grab that image, we build our infrastructure, and we push that on the dev stage. So this is like oversimplified day of the work of the developer. And if we see that that feature is good, we want to merge it to the master. We do the merging to the master, and we go through the same CI/CD pipeline with the difference that this time we are pushing to different accounts, like Amazon accounts or the Azure subscriptions. So to the QA stage, product owners checks and says like, yeah, that's a feature, cool, that works fine, and we go to the production. So we have the full workflow. And let's take the examples of summarizing what I said about all of the things before. So on the stage of IDEA, like I mentioned, we could use some of the tools, and these are maybe not the best font, like the Dev Scheme, Puma, Coverity, 45. All of them are providing, some of them are open source. It depends which language you're using. You can always find the extension for your IDEA and plug it. Then work with the team and think about the pre-commit hooks, like if you're pushing code to the GitHub or GitLab, it doesn't matter. Check this stuff. And definitely the first and the foremost feature, what I always also say, that there are no direct code pushes towards the master. So you should have a master protection of the master, only the merging the branches and only with the approval. But that's a next step. Okay, and when we speak about the repository itself, like I mentioned, there are different ways of the scanning dependency management. These could be like the wide source vault. They do provide the extensions for free, SNCC, if you are in the GitHub. So there are plenty of the tools which helps you to check your source code and particularly your dependencies for the security state, for the licensing and for the security state, and give immediate feedback. And another good pattern is if you are signing your code, or at least you're signing tags. Because if I would be a hacker, it's like, you know, it's only in the movies when the hacker is like going deeply breaking the cryptography and so on. In reality, we tend to look for the easier way. And the best way is to compromise, for example, someone's machine, someone's credentials. And if I compromise someone's credentials, I will push the code directly. And I can inject my code to your repository. So the best way is to sign the code. And if you can afford that, it works very well for the organizations which are doing like in-house development. So if it's open source project, then it's kind of more tricky. But if it's like in-house development, then think about the signing the code. So you are approving only the signed code from the known developers. In worst case, what you can think is like when you're making the new features, you always can sign the tags also. Okay, so, and this is where you also integrating security analysis tools, like the static analysis tools, check marks, Coverity, 45, start with the SonarQube. SonarQube is not only about the quality, they also have the patterns to check for the security. So that's a good start. Okay, so on the CI/CD pipeline, you can implement the different stuff, like I mentioned, the tests and the pen tests. So this is where you would look on implementing the task, again, open source solution, OWASP ZAP scanning tool, which you can place as a, make it as a Docker and make it as a task in your CI/CD pipeline. Then infrastructure as a code. So like I said, but the best way to check infrastructure, if it is as a code, so you can check against the some security violations. It depends, of course, which type of the infrastructure as a code templating you're taking. There are the tools which helps you actually to check that. And scanning, again, I discussed host intrusion detection systems and so on. And I would like also to emphasize the Docker stuff, since a lot of the development happens in the containers. So two things. The first one, if you are doing the containers, then think about the hardening of the containers. Even the Kubernetes, Docker is having the separate page of the security best practices, which explains how you should harden your images. And we recently have faced with some security vulnerabilities in images, so it's worth to think about the hardening. Another thing is to implement the concept of the scanning of your images. So you have the container registry, and there are the commercial tools which scans your images for you, which are placed in these repositories. So basically, the concept is pretty similar, like we discussed with the SNUC and the YSource, against the source code. There are the tools which scans your Docker images, the containers, and this is what you implement against the container registry. Okay, and when you are in the cloud, then it's all about utilizing the cloud provider's monitoring solution. It's all about like using the vulnerability scanning tools, which runs on the background and gives you the statistic what is happening directly back to your team. So these things, they may sound hard, but when you're moving to the cloud providers are helping you a lot by providing some of these practices out of the box. When it comes to the CI/CD pipeline, it's all about just adding some tasks in your YAML and taking and reading a bit more documentation maybe from the OWASP. And usually you should, if you have the security on your place, security team, who is maybe still thinks in the old concept, like protecting infrastructure from the perimeter and firewalls is all about that. Don't be shy, grab that security person and ask him to work with you like for the week, for the 2 weeks. I went through that. I was working with the development team with just on some features and so on. It's enough to be like the observer to get understanding how the concepts are working, how the development team works in the DevOps, and then you when you see like the mindset starts to change, and the security could help you to implement these things. You can have the dedicated person who is just implementing all that stuff in your team. So it's all about finding the right balance. But at least I would suggest to start with the one of the few tools from this list to get implementing DevSecOps. And if you are wondering what type of the tools are available, I'm not speaking about the commercial. There is a good poster from the SANS. So basically, that's called the Secure DevOps Toolchain, which gives the tools, open source tools, the list for the different clouds and for the different stages, when you are like on the infrastructure, when you're developing, when you're doing the CI/CD, and so on. So it's worth to look into that. And think about, we do DevOps. So we are responsible for the security, we are responsible for the quality. And only then we can say, we work as a team. And when we can say, we work as a DevOps. Because if you just implemented the tools but not taking the responsibility for the quality, that's not a DevOps. There are a few resources. And as I know, the slides are going to be shared. So you can go through the slides later and also grab these links. And if you will have more questions afterwards, because I know sometimes it takes thinking, you can always contact me on the Twitter or write me directly. I'm always keen to see the challenging questions and answer on them. And that was about the security in the CI/CD pipeline and about the DevSecOps. Any questions? If you don't have a question or you don't want to speak loud, you can catch me afterwards here. I will be all day here. So, and again, thanks for coming and thanks for staying. And I hope that it was interesting and it was not only because of the coffee, but I don't want to stay between you and the lunch right now. So again, thank you.